And we're gonna get Michelle's reaction to everything. Jenny's gonna let her in. And then I'm going to go and light this candle.
Hi, people. I don't know who's gonna watch this.
You feel me already?
I walked in and I was like, hi, people.
Whoever. I just Father God and make the Holy Spirit may be amongst us, Lord God. And Lord, I pray, amen.
Amen. You guys ready? Mm-hmm. Quiet on set in 3, 2, 1. What am I gonna get?
Why I like that burn smell.
Okay.
Mom's gonna be like, you're catching my house on fire again.
Again? We never did that.
Earlier, you almost.
Okay, I almost caught my house on fire.
It's okay, I did it too.
Literally, guys.
I walked in. I didn't even get a high. I just got, oh my God.
We're not gonna talk about it.
No, because, okay,
you
I was trying to light this candle.
You were supposed to put water in the cup of noodles. And you didn't do that.
You put in microwave like that?
I remember your mom telling me that. Oh my gosh. No, I was literally trying to light this up, so I got a paper towel.
And then the
whole paper towel literally lit on fire. And I was like, guys, help! Anyways, we're about to get started with the podcast. Hey guys, welcome back to It's Just Tawny, the podcast, The Light in the Darkness. I have not been on, it's been a whole year, guys. It's been a while. So, as you guys can tell, I am the only host from now on. As you guys know, Faith used to be on this, and she used to co-host. But she is no longer with us, and we send her the best of love and wishes. Please do not put any hate comments or any hate towards her. We love her. We care for her. She's just no longer going to be with us at this very moment. If you hear any noises from the background, we have, like, my baby cousins over, and also we have my cool cousins. If any other cousins is watching this, you're cool too. But we have, say your name.
Emmy.
And?
Charles.
And we have a live audience today for our first podcast. So we have my first guest actually ever on this. We're going to be doing like a little mukbang as well. Guys, look at this cake. There's like, I don't know what's on it. I tried to spell your name. But then the icing, because I forgot it's icing, it like literally melted into just one blob. So this was supposed to say Michelle, and then you kind of see the M. And then that was supposed to say love you, but yeah. No, it's okay.
I'm sorry, it
kind of looks a little bit different now because we had to refilm it because there was just a lot of noise by dog Coco. But so let's first of all, your name. We need your name, your age, your address, your social security number. We need your address, you know what I'm saying?
Why?
Oh, no.
For some of the
director again. Yeah.
That's
nice. The feds. Just kidding. Your age? Are you single? Are you taken?
Michelle Landerer Valdivia. I just turned 24 and okay. I am as single as a Pringle.
Same.
Not ready to mingle. I don't want to do it.
Same. Actually, I don't know, because like some, like 1% of me does. 99% of me doesn't.
No, I don't.
We love that. So, this podcast is going to be about the comeback. Are you ready?
Yeah. What the heck was that?
It was my clock lift, dude. Yeah. This is my black clock lift, so I can wash them later. But let's get started. So, when did you get saved? A little brief. Sorry, there's something there.
So, like, fast forward. Well, like, there was, like, a seed, I guess, first planted when I was around middle school. But, you know, like, a seed of, like, you know, and actually, like, gaining knowledge of, like, who Christ is around 18, 19. And I feel like that really, like, sparked some sort of, like, curiosity as to, like, you know, trying to learn and grow, you know, and be able to, like, what is this? Who is this? And I remember I only had one day off during the time that I was working. And I was working like 12 to 20 hour shifts, you know, 6 days a week. Driving like an hour and a half to get to work.
Bro,
you know?
That's crazy.
Yeah. And then the church I was originally going to was like maybe like 40 minutes, an hour away from work. So it was just like, that was the closest one that I knew of.
Yeah.
And I would go Sunday. So I would still go and then go right back to work, you know? And I remember, like, God, like, I've never heard of church on a Wednesday, but, you know, nothing's impossible for you, and you're seeing that I'm trying to do this, but it's just, it's hard. It's just draining me. Like, I can't keep, you know, like, I'm trying, but, like, I can't keep doing this. Like,
yeah,
you know, this is just, like, I've almost crashed a million times that I did end up crashing, you know? It's just, like, and I remember, because I was living out here in Stockton.
Yeah.
And we're driving by, like, the 99 and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And, you guys were outreaching. You guys were outreaching. And I remember just driving through, and, like, people were, like, handing out, like, flyers and stuff. You know, and it was what Pastor Zach, Rachel? I think her name is Rachel. Pastor Zach and Rachel. Rachel was pregnant with their first child. And I remember just looking at it real quick, because I was like, what is this? You know, and then she said something about the church, and I just seen just the word Wednesday. You know, and I was like, well, Wednesdays are my only days off. You know, I remember laughing, and she's like, what? And I was like, I've been praying about church, because it's like, I'm trying to, like, you know, start my walk, and it's just like, there's no churches open Wednesdays, like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I was like, all right, you know. And like, and that was like shortly after, maybe a few weeks after. And I started going, and I think that was like their last week or the last couple weeks that they were going to be there.
Yeah.
And then pastor came, you know? So now I got, you know, my pastor. Like, growing up, I feel like I had to, like, try my hardest to provide or try to work or try to this or try to that, where it was just, yeah, like, you know, trusting and having faith, basically. And, you know, someone that, like, wasn't there, I couldn't see, I couldn't just straight up have a conversation to speak with directly, where, like, they'll respond like that, like, you know what I mean, where it's like, and I'm still learning how to hear God's voice at the time and everything, where it was just like, you know, like, my finances, like, I need to do this, like, I need to figure this out.
Yeah.
You know, and it was just like, back then I realized it was that test of faith of, like, you know, trusting. And I remember I went to the Bay Area, and I got stuck out there because of my car, like, because I had crashed already, and then,
bro, I feel like I remember that.
Yeah, because,
like, I feel like I remember, because we started getting close, and then, like, all of a sudden, you're gone. Like, mm-hmm. You're just gone, and I'm just like, where did she go, bro?
Yeah, like, I got stuck out there, and then it was just also just that, like, I think it was just that fear, you know, of also, yeah, like, you know, they pay more out there, like, out here, there's nothing, you know, but it's just like, you know, I had to just trust God, you know, yeah, stop trusting myself. But, you know, I ended up getting stuck out there, and, you know, knowing what Egypt now is and all these things, where it's like, that was my Egypt. And there was a reason why God was just, like, trying to pull me back.
Yeah.
You know, even pastor's wife, like, Leandra, was like, I'll go get you. You know, like, I'll go pick you up. Like, you need, yeah, to come back. You know, and I just remember just being like, this girl, like, go home, girl. You don't even know me. Like, no. No, thank you. Like, I need to work. Like, I need to do this. Like, you don't understand. You,
yeah,
know? And I was stuck out there, and then I ended up staying out there for like 4 years. I got in a relationship, and then it just ended up turning abusive, and it was just so draining. And I remember just like falling even more into drugs, even heavier drugs, you know, and just becoming more depressed, more of an angry person. And mind you, in my head, like, I knew I was backsliding, because it's like, I'm like, no, at this point, like, I know God, I know of God, I know Jesus, like, and, you know, every single time I would go out or drink or this or drink and drive or do drugs or whatever, like, I knew that I'm gonna go to hell, because I know what's right and wrong. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And I remember when I finally came back, it was just like, at that point, like, I had already hit rock bottom, you know, where it was like, I fell even deeper. Like, I became an alcoholic, and I became addicted to crystal meth. Where I was like, dude, like, that's something I said I was never gonna touch, you know?
Yeah.
One of the things I said I was never gonna touch, and look, I touched it, and now I became addicted, mm-hmm, so quickly. You know, I was like, no, like, this is rock bottom. And I remember too, like, even when I used, like, acknowledging the fact that I don't care anymore,
mm-hmm,
because the addiction is taking over, but my spirit inside, like, knowing what's right and wrong, even though I didn't feel it, where I'm not, like, crying and everything, I'm like, no, this isn't right, like, because, like, this is more than just me, like, who's it gonna affect? Like, you know, I might not care right now, but it's gonna affect so many people. Like, do I really want this to see myself like this? Like, do I really want others to see me like this? And that's when I came back, you know, and I rededicated my life to Christ, you know. And it's just like, since then, it's just like, just still trying to push forward and do everything I can to really know God. And I feel like that's when, like, my relationship really just, like, peaked, you know. And it's just been, like, shooting up as much as I can, like, just growing as much as I can, even more. So I guess you could say I got saved around like 18 or 19, you know, and then, you know, rededicated my life when I was 23.
And you're how old now?
24. So about a year back.
That's what's up.
Mm-hmm. A year and
I would do applause edits, but too lazy. So I know, we have like the best audience ever. So how did you view God? Let's do this. How did you view God as a child? Like literally like a child. Let's say like, how old are you, Charlie?
9.
Right, how old are you, Emmy?
13.
So how did you view God at like 9? If you knew him, if you didn't, how did you view God at 13? And how do you view him now?
I feel like around like 9, I guess you could say, like, I didn't understand how to view him. I just knew there's a God because my grandma would always be like, you know, Dios this, Dios that, you know, like, Dios castiga, like, don't do this. God is going to punish you, like, you know, like, or you don't lie, you don't steal, you don't hit, you don't this, you don't that, like, Dios castiga. Like, I feel like any Latinos is, like, it's a common thing you hear.
Yeah.
So in my head, I'm like, dang, like, just anxiety and just, like, always, like, on your toes. It's not even just on your toes. Like, if you're, like, someone that's, like, running the streets, not just, like, on your toes about something that's gonna happen to you because of the law or because of people. It's like even worse. It's like, man, Dios castiga. I'm like, man, like just that paranoia, you know? So I feel like I didn't understand what to feel, but I guess it was like a fear, and it wasn't a healthy fear, because when it says in the Bible, fear the Lord, it's like a healthy fear of the Lord. You know, you fear him because you love him, because you fear hurting him. You know, you fear letting him down, but not in a, dang, I just let him down and I'm just like the worst thing ever. Like, no, we're all sinners. We all fall short. But it's that fear of hurting him. The fear of like, dang, like he did all this and I still just like, you know, I keep going, running right back to sin, where it's just like, you know, but that's another thing. It's like God wants us to call upon him so he can take that from us, you know, but it's like still that fear. It's a different type of fear. It's not a fear like he's going to beat me. He's gonna beat me to death. You know, it's like, it's different. But I feel like as a kid, I didn't understand that neither. It was like a fear. And I guess around like her age, you know, around 13 or so, like, I guess you could say that was around the time with my stepmom too, you know, where it was just like, she was a hypocritical Christian. I didn't understand, you know, too much. And I guess I still didn't understand who Jesus was. I remember just hearing about God and like, you know, you'll hear about Christ, like, you know, like it's his son, but not understanding the true depth that, like, he died for us, like, everything that really, like, is behind it, you know? Like, you hear people just, like, throwing his name in vain, like, you know, cussing and everything, too, but it's just, like, you know the name, but do you know who he is? You know the story behind it, you know? And I feel like then too, like knowing that there was a God, I remember like times of just being depressed, like even times like before, like right before, even nights where I would try to kill myself, like, you know, just crying like, God, just take this pain away from
me. At that age of 13.
Yeah, around that age, but not understanding, like, you know, again, just the depth of it, you know?
Yeah.
And just knowing that there's someone there, just like if you're there, like, you know what I mean? And growing older, and like once I really knew him, it's like I'm thankful that I didn't succeed. I'm thankful that, you know, like, even though it hurts, even though I have my moments where I'm like, dang, like as a kid, like nobody should go through certain things, but
yeah,
it's like that created me
to who you are now,
to who I am. It's taking it from you without you realizing it. Like, he's just bringing you that peace, you know?
Yeah. So how did you deal with, like, when you would see people die, like family members at a young age, how did you view that? Like, in a sense of you were younger, right? And how do you view it now? Like,
Well, I feel like hearing about people passing away, I feel like the one that really impacted me was my cousin, because she was like older and she was like a bigger sister. And when she passed away, the whole family dispersed. Like, everyone went to their own ways. Everyone went to different cities. Like, nobody really talks. If anyone talks, it's arguing or it's just, it's garbage, you know? So she was, like, everyone's kid, and she was, like, the glue. And I remember just, like, not understanding. I'm just, like, she was such a good person, and she had such a good heart. Like, I remember, like, at her funeral, too, like, the whole block was filled with people. Where, like, people couldn't fit in the building. Like, people would be driving by, like, who was it? You know, like, thinking it was some celebrity. In my head, I'm just like, no, like, this, she had that big of a heart where she impacted lives, you know? And growing up, you know, like, I didn't understand it. Thinking about it now, I'm like, who knows how God could have used her because of the heart she had then in the world. Imagine the heart she would have had for Christ, you know? And I don't know. I think I just questioned it where it was just like, that's unfair.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I was just like, that's unfair. Like, you know, I know you do things for a reason. We don't always understand. Like, you always hear that. You know, like, everything happens for a reason. God knows why he does things. Like, even unbelievers, like, say that. You know? But it's just, like, to really understand and know it. Like, you know, it's just, like, now, it's, like, it's gonna hurt. But leaving it in God's hands and understanding that, you know, their purpose, you know, saved or not, it's their time. Nobody can fight it. Even when I wasn't saved, it's, like, knowing that you can't fight God on that, no matter what. You know, there's moments where someone could die and come back to life, or, you know, someone could die and it's like everyone was praying, and it's just like, but there's times like that where I'm just like, but God knows why he does that. Maybe it's so you guys could have all pushed and built your faith on that.
Very briefly, like, why does that hurt you? In a sense, like, for the people who don't know necessarily, what does saved mean? Why does it matter if they're saved when they die? Why does all of that even, what does that have to do with anything, right? For the people who just don't know.
Yeah. Well, it's like eternal life or eternal death. Like, it's not just like, oh, you're just dead and you're just in darkness forever. Like, no, you're going to be going through torment forever, you know? And I know that, like, you know, it's like if somebody dies today and they don't know God, or they, you know, it's like God always gives us at least one chance, and I believe he gives us multiple chances.
But what if they know God?
If they know God,
because everybody knows of God.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. But I know that, like, God always puts someone in everyone's path, in every single person's path before they die, at least once, and I believe multiple times, to spread the gospel, to know the truth, because, like, anyone can know of God.
To spread that seed, to have a relationship.
To have a relationship and to really know the true depth of it. You know, it's not just a word thrown around. You know, so it hurts, like, you know, if they're backslidden or if they reject him or if they're like, eh. You know, because it's like in the moment, or it's like if they do die in that sin, in their day of judgment, like once they're over here, like having to, like, be face to face with God, it's like that regret is going to wash over you. It's like, imagine you just being in sin right now and you just facing God. Like, you know, like, all of these flashbacks are gonna come and you can be like, dang, like, give me one more chance. Like, no, you were giving these chances multiple times, you know? It's like things like that. That's why it would hurt, because, like, you're filled with that, you know? You're gonna be filled with that. Me just putting myself in their shoes of, like, dang, like, there's nothing you can do anymore.
Yeah, that's one thing that, like, so we'd went to a funeral. And I remember, like, I was crying. Like, I just started crying because I was just like, man, like, I don't think he was saved. Like, I don't think he was saved. And something that I know is that, like, my brother, he did make up and tell him, like, he actually is in his heart and all that. And it's sad when I see, especially my family members that didn't know Jesus, knowing that. Well, we never will know, because they could have had the chance to cry out to Jesus, right?
Yeah.
Like, whether in whatever it is. But it makes me sad to even have the chance of thought, because everybody has a choice. Mm-hmm. Like, my cousins that used to come over to my house, like I wish that I would have, you know, not been a hypocrite Christian. Because I was. I was very hypocritical. We would come to my house, we would be doing crazy things, and then we would go to church the next day.
Yeah.
And I wish I never would have done that, because now they want nothing to do with me. Because once I started being a Christian, and once I started saying the truth to them, once I started loving them but not covering their sin anymore, and once I started speaking about what I believed in, they wanted nothing to do with me.
Yeah.
And which, it's not the problem. It's not like every time I'm with my cousins, I bring up the gospel. But it's like, because they know what I stand for and who I used to be, it's like they want nothing to do with me. So it's sad to say, like, I know if they die right now, they will go straight to hell. They won't make heaven their home. And it sucks, because I was the influence on them.
Yeah.
We only really see, like, each other when it's quinceañeras or weddings or funerals, and even then, at quinceañeras, at funerals, at like parties, we're all fighting about something stupid.
Yeah.
And it's like, we don't have each other for long. Why are we fighting? Why do we have these such busy schedules, but we can't make time for our family? And it's like the same thing with God.
Yeah.
We have all this time. We have 24 hours, 365 days in a year. And we can't even spend 5 minutes to say thank you, God, for like everything that I have. And just read the Bible to hear from him, or just like go to church. Like, it's not that much if you really think about it.
Mm-hmm.
We have so much time, and it's really not that much. I just want to ask you, like, as a Christian, like, now what has God been showing you lately? Like, what has he been showing you to go back to or to go stay away from?
Lately, I feel like he's been, like, you know, telling me to just go back to my first love. It's like that first love with him, that first fresh fire, like, you know, where it's just like the flame that just would grow and grow and grow, and was just like never going out, you know, and just go back to that, you know, just dig back in, like my heels into my faith,
yeah,
you know, and dive in, just dive in deep. You
know? If you don't mind me asking, why do you need to go back to your first love? Like, did you fall out of love? Why? How? What made you fall out of love with Christ?
I feel like I did, you know, but not intentionally, obviously. Yeah. I feel like we never do that intentionally, but
for sure,
you know, I let distractions, you know, come into my life, and it was just a relationship, even a relationship in the church, a relationship that, you know, the authoritative figure that God placed into my life, like, you know, even said, you know, don't do this to both of us. You guys gotta wait. You guys gotta do it the right way. You know, we didn't listen. We let our feelings get in the way, and you know, we just did our own thing, you know, and because it wasn't done right, because, you know, it just, even though, like, we were doing everything else right, obviously, like, there's sin in there,
yeah.
You know, and that's, you know, spiritual, like, there's, like, you know, fornication or things like that that happen, and it's just, like, that is spiritual, like, and those are things that just latch onto you.
For
and
sure.
Cause so much, like, evil, because it's just, like, it's evil.
Yeah.
And I feel like it was just very distracting. And then, like, you know, backsliding happened. You know, I remember I had used it a few times. But, and it was just like, you know what? No, like, I can't do this. You know, but I know that, like, you know, he had used a few times and he fell off, like, multiple times. And it wasn't so easy for him to get right back up. And he was just stuck in it, like, losing his mind the few times that he, like, you know, would use or drink. And I was just always eating the short end of the stick. You know, dealing with that verbal abuse, dealing with this complete opposite person where I'm just like, I didn't sign up for this and I don't deserve this.
Proves, like, just how gracious God is. Mm-hmm. Like, he gives chance after chance after chance to just with this person.
Exactly.
So, like, what has been the hardest thing falling back into love with Jesus, and how has you falling back, you know, and into, you know, backsliding and into temptations and into your feelings, how has that, you know, affected your relationship with Jesus, and how, what has been the hardest thing, you know, just coming back to Christ?
One of the hardest things is, well, I know God forgives us, and it's just like, he never lets us go. We're the ones that let go, or we're the ones that walk away, or we're the ones that just give up on ourselves, or, you know, and I feel like one of the hardest things is, like, I was talking to Pastor about this the other day, where I didn't even realize it. It's just like, I feel like I've been holding on by a string, because I'm trying. You know, but he's like, I remember him telling me, and like, I don't know if you saw me, like, I was like, starting to shed a few tears, where I was like, dang, like, you know, where he's like, your heart for God is there, like, all this stuff, where it's just like, you're there, you know, yeah. Like, I don't doubt that your heart is so, like, you're never letting God go, but it's like, you beat yourself up too much, like, you can't let it be off performance and put yourself where you're just like, man, like, I messed up, and now it's like, you know, you let go because you're like, what's the point? I can't do any of this.
So the hardest thing would be being hard on yourself.
I'm too hard on myself, you know, that's
for
the hardest
sure.
thing. And it's just like trying my best not to be, and just how he's been saying, like, you know, even if you take 2 steps back today, take another step forward tomorrow, or 3 steps forward, you know, and you might take 2 steps back,
yeah.
But do better the next day than the day before, you
know? So how are you overcoming this? Like,
I think it's just also just like being able to fellowship, and I know that God, like how I said, like Pastor had just talked to me about this. What was it, yesterday during Bible study? And I didn't even realize certain things, or I didn't know, I guess, the words to speak. And I feel like him just speaking these things, because
so speaking to people.
Yeah, just the fellowship and speaking wisdom. To people. Yeah, getting wisdom, and God just speaks through them. You know what I mean?
Like, for sure.
And just little things like that, like just that conversation, like really helped me, because I didn't realize I needed that.
Yeah.
You know, and him just acknowledging it and kind of like giving those words, like speaking those words and like basically bringing them out of me, where I'm like, those are the words that I needed to hear, and those are the words that I've been feeling, but I didn't know how to put them into perspective.
For sure.
You know? And yeah, I mean, it's just that, you know.
I think it's so good to have like leadership, whether it's in your pastor, or maybe people don't have a relationship with their pastor, but whether it's a friend or a brother or sister in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, like you, like I always have you and Kaylee. We love Kaylee. I feel like I'm always talking about you guys and Miss Halle. Like, you guys have been such a, like, inspiration to my life. Like, y'all are just, I'm like, oh my gosh. Like, for you example, I'm like, okay, she can fast, I can fast. Like, she always says this thing where it's like, if you want it, you'll get it. Or like, what do you say?
Yeah, if you want it, you'll get it.
Because she's a gym rat. Probably guy. No, I'm just kidding. So yeah, I think like that's like a big inspiration, like that you are for me and for Kaylee. She just like a lot of with her family, like everything that she goes through, and just like things in general in her spiritual walk. I feel like everybody that like you and Kaylee, I'm very spiritually connected with. So it's like when you go through crap, I've already been through that crap, or if I'm going through crap, you've been through that crap, or we're going through the same crap at the same time, and that's the same thing.
Figure
with
it out together.
Yeah, and that's the same thing with Kaylee, but like in different ways. And Miss Helen, yeah. She's just so wise. I look up to her so much. I look up to all of you guys so much, and I'm just like, and my Atha Eunice, I'm just like, I want to be all of you guys in one for the, like, everybody in my life, like my family, my friends, my, you know.
For the kingdom.
For the kingdom, and just people that I'm working with, or, you know, just everybody I'm around. I'm just like, I need a little bit of all of you, like, inside of me, and I think that's just so important. But what's advice that you'd give to your younger self? You know, that you, like, you wish you would have known, or you wish you would have had.
Don't beat yourself up, you know, like, don't be focused on all the mistakes that have happened. Don't be focused on anyone's opinions of you, you know, and I wish I would have known about Christ sooner and started following him and understanding that even now that I'm older, like, there's gonna be family and friends and just people around you where they're just, like, you know, looking at you like you're a square. But you know what? Like, at the end of the day, you knowing the truth is way better, you know? And you having that love and that peace and that securement in Christ that nobody can give you, you know, it's like, hold on to that. You know, because at the end of the day, like, he's the only one that will never leave you or abandon you or forsake you or hurt you. You know, some people could be like, oh, well, he didn't do this, he didn't do that. He's not a genie. You
for
know,
sure.
But it's just like, he's going to give you what you need, not what you want.
He knows what we might say we need things, but he knows what we actually need.
He knows what we need, and he knows our heart's desires. And sometimes we don't even know our heart's desires. Like, we say we want something, but once we get it, we don't want it.
Yeah.
That's why he doesn't always give us things. And
for
sometimes
sure.
We might want something, but it's not what we need. We need this to grow. We need a no to learn that we can't have everything our way all the time. That's like a kid. You can't give them everything, and then they're just going to be a spoiled brat.
Yeah, for
sure. And learn
sure.
nothing. Learn not, like, they're not going to work for themselves, or they're not going to appreciate people. They're not going to appreciate the things that they have. You know, it's just things like that. Where
and it builds our character. It builds who we are.
Yeah, it's character building, too. Yeah. Be a sheep for Jesus.
Simple
for sure.
As that. So, as we close in, the last, like, three questions we have before we just close up, who inspires you to keep going? Who's your biggest inspiration? Obviously not like Jesus, because like that. She'd be like, guys, Jesus.
I feel like my younger self, you know, as well as like part of me now sometimes, like God, like helping me learn to love myself. you know, and it's like accept love and accept love for myself because, you know, God is the only one that can give you a true revelation of what love is. But I feel like you also have to love yourself. You know, you're going to love others too as you learn to love yourself, but love yourself enough, you know, because if you don't love yourself, as well as obviously knowing the true love of Christ, you're not going to be able to love anyone else.
For sure.
You love yourself first too, because this is the Holy Spirit's temple, you know, like the one that you are in, you know, and the Holy Spirit's in you, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's just like, I guess like myself, my younger self and the things that I've learned, and it's just kind of like, you know, wanting to be better, you know, that person that I never had, you know, that love, that light, you know, of Christ shining through somebody, you know, as well as like my niece and nephew, you know, because it's like, I don't ever want them to go through what I went through, but also letting them know, like, I can only do so much for you, but it's like Christ can do even greater things than anyone else.
Yeah, for sure. So the last T question, who's your favorite rapper?
My favorite Christian rapper has always been Brian Trejo because...
Hey, we love Brian Trejo! We're gonna, like, cut that. We're gonna, like, post it and, like, have him, like, to get tagged.
He's like, what?
Get her on the track! Ryan T, get her on the track! She'd be like, what's it called? Daughter of a King? Bro, that song is so fire!
That song is so fire. Why did it come out right when we were going through so much?
Because it doesn't run as raw and a pedal something. I know the song, I promise. Ryan T.
We're on the spot. We don't know it right now, but we know it.
We know it. That song is fire.
I feel like it's Ryan T because he was like the first rapper I heard even when I first entered that Bible study in that tattoo shop, you know, where it was like that actual seed of like the understanding revelation of Jesus.
Yeah.
Like they would play him. I remember like they'd have him on TV, they'd be playing music videos and stuff, like he'd be there where I'm just like, man, like Christian rap, like this sounds cool. And it's like, I remember his first few albums, like of the parables, like, you know, of like, I would learn, like, you know, now when I read them or even when I first started reading certain Bible stories, like would play in my head.
Right.
Because like songs would play in my head. And I feel like that's another thing. It's like Christ uses music for me. And he straight up speaks to me. Like anyone could, you know, he could use it for anybody, but it's like, that's one of the things, like he knows, like, that's how she listens, you know?
For
it's
sure.
Like, and that's how he uses it. And I feel like even sometimes, like, it helps me memorize and remember
scripture,
remember, like, the parables and, like, the stories in the Bible, the characters, you know, even learn things that I didn't even catch in
some new revelation.
New revelation just in songs. For sure. It's just like, but that's, like, one of the first person that I got introduced to. And after that, like, it branched off, but... that's always been like the just my go back where it was like, no, like that's the first person I ever heard and that's the person that really impacted me as an artist.
For sure. And just as we close, the last question. So what Bible scripture or book of the Bible has really, really helped you get to where you are now, or as well as just like a big like part of your life and inspiration?
I feel like there's a lot of scriptures, but I feel like the ones that have been helping me lately, you know, are a couple in Ezekiel. I feel like even with everything, there's two that I can read right now. But like the first one, you know, it's like when I was in that relationship, you know, a while ago, like where they were backslidden and I was over here trying to do right. And I was just basically eating all that garbage, you know. I feel like God spoke to me when I started reading Ezekiel.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then, so I'll just read the first scripture, but it's Ezekiel, 2:6-8. And you, son of man, do not be afraid of them, nor be afraid of their words. Though briars and thorns are with you, and you dwell among scorpions, do not be afraid of their words or dismayed by their looks, though they are a rebellious house. You shall speak my words to them, whether they hear or whether they refuse, for they are rebellious. But you, son of man, hear what I say to you. Do not be rebellious like the rebellious house. Open your mouth and eat what I give you. So it's like, even though they were like, you know, having the moments of just straight trashing me, because it's like, you're backslidden and you're on drugs and you're, you know, you're wasted. It's like, you're just an ugly person, you know? And it's just like, I remember feeling like, God, like, I don't need this. Like, shut their mouth.
Yeah.
Like, Lord, mute them like you did John's dad. Like, just do it, you know?
Yeah.
It's just like...
I prayed that prayer too. Not for good reasons. Not for good reasons. It's not good. Let's talk about that.
Just do it.
I'm just like, please.
Just cut that part.
But it's just like... But it's just like, everywhere I was going through it, and it's just like, he was just like, reminding me, it's like, how I said, it's like, they're rebellious people, like, don't be consumed by what they, how they look at you, you know, whether it's ugly words, ugly looks, you know, and it's just like, don't let it consume you, don't listen, you know, because, like, you're surrounded by these things, you know, because in the moment I was surrounded by it, it was just like, I was living with this person, it's like, that was just consuming everything, we were so distracting, and so just like, it was draining emotionally, spiritually, and it was just like, oh my gosh. And how it says, like, you know, it's like you speak what I give you to speak. If they don't listen, they're rebellious, but don't rebel like them.
Yeah.
You know?
So obey, like basically like obey
and just follow. Yeah, don't fall. Don't stoop to their level. Oh, beautiful. You know what I mean? So it's just like, that's something else that I've been holding on to. Like that first scripture that I read, it was like something that was happening between everything that was going on, and it was just like, even with dealing with like so many mixed emotions and so much anger, so much frustration, even towards God, but it's like also like acknowledging, like, God, like, you know, not too long ago too, like, I feel like I didn't understand what those feelings were, you know, and acknowledging, like, realizing, you know what, like, no, I do have bitterness and irritation and anger. It's like, it's deep in there, no matter how much I try to push down, like, you're put at these walls, like, I notice, like, I'm getting an attitude lately, or I'm this, or I'm that. I'm like, where is this stooping from? You know, no matter how much I try, no matter how much I read or anything. And I feel like God revealed to me, it's just like, you're still angry, like, at this person. Like, you know, no matter how much you try not to be bitter and resentful, like, you need to acknowledge the hurt, you know, that you feel, you know, so that you may heal from it. You know, it's like, acknowledge, like, your sin amongst each other so that you may heal. Even though you're not over here, like, beating somebody, it's, like, you feeling like that. Like, he doesn't want us to have that because, like, hate. And hate is, like, murder to him. But it's still, it's, like, there's a lot of healing done just by speaking sometimes. You know? And it's just, like, you don't even need a response. It's just letting it out. And that's what God was, like, you need to let it out. And then I feel like he was also pulling out of me, like, you were upset at me, too.
Yeah.
You know? And I remember, like, right when, like, you know, it's, like, acknowledging that, I broke down crying, where it was just like, man, like, you know, you're right, like, and I don't understand why, like, you know, and it's still upsetting, like, you know, and I don't want to be, so forgive me for being upset at you, God, but you know what, like, and I know your grace is enough, you know, and it's like, if it was me, you would have done the same, you know, like, it's just like, just showing the grace, maybe in a different, you would have given whatever back on a different level, but it's like, I can't question you, but yeah. I can let you know I feel like this because I know you at least want to hear that, you know? And I feel like just a weight being lifted off, like, okay, you finally talked to me about it. But yeah.
Yeah. Okay, that is the end of our podcast. We're going to close in prayer. And then I heard you saying, how great is our God. You remember that?
Oh, yeah.
You remember that song?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll sing that song after. And then
we're left to see.
Have dealt with any of this, and you want to just accept Jesus into your heart, and he'll help you make that change. And the next step after you say this prayer will be to read your Bible and to pray and to get into a church. We have over 3,000 churches worldwide under the Potter's House, the Door. But just message me on Instagram.
I'm on Instagram too, but even though I don't always post, go ahead and message me if you need to.
Yes.
I still It'll
be in the description. But let's close in prayer. If you want to ask Jesus in your heart, just say this, repeat after me. Say, Jesus, I pray that you come into my heart, be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you died on the cross and rose again on the third day. I thank you for saving me, and I pray that you will help me to build a relationship with you, and to hunger and to thirst for you. In Jesus' name, amen. And the next step after that will just be reading your Bible. If you don't have a Bible, just, there's like things online or something. Or if you need one, just message me. We'll try to get one out to you. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, we're going to end the song by, end the podcast by singing How Great Is Our God.
also, yeah, I guess another step would be like, don't be afraid to reach out.
Yes.
You know, like, have questions or just speak up on what it is you're lost on, or just questions, or just, you know.
Just say it out loud.
Just let it out. Don't ever be scared, because at the end of the day, like, that's what each of us are here for.
So it's like more like a talking, you know what I'm saying? Talking. And they're about to get free foot pics right now. They're about to eat that up. Look, they're about to eat her feet up, guys.